everyone. Thank you for everyone who's logged in so far. My name is Pooja Johari. I am the CEO for The Glitch. We're a full-service creative agency under the WPP umbrella. And today we're going to speak to this amazing panelist. And before I get to that, just a quick context setting on what you can expect today. Digital is central to marketing, and that, you know, that's no longer a debate, and especially in these unprecedented times. COVID has been the chief technology / transformation officer for so many organizations who are undecided towards the various modern marketing options available to us. There are sophisticated tools out there, and companies are upskilling their talent. They have to be able to make the most of it. While the industry is still gearing up for new technologies like blockchain, AR, VR, AI, etc., their impact is still yet to be measured. There are many tools that have been game changers for the marketing community. So today, with these bunch of sharp minds, we will discuss their success stories, learnings, and watchouts in the areas of MarTech. To everyone listening in, the session is divided into three main focus areas, so it's a meaningful listen for all of you. At the end of the discussion, we'll take questions. So I'm going to keep looking at the chat window. Do keep sending that in. We're also live on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. So please use the hashtag E4M webinar while posting. So let's get into a quick introduction to our panelists. I'm delighted to introduce Ruchira Jaitley, CMO, HMD. It's the home of our beloved Nokia phones. A B2C business and marketing professional. She has worked in stints across sales, marketing, and even led a B2C startup for home care, personal care, food, and beverage. Welcome, Ruchira. Moving to Taranjeet. Taran is Managing Director for Southeast Asia and India at Criteo. He's responsible for driving continued growth and steering Criteo's business strategy for the region, and has had stellar past stints with Z5 and Twitter. Hi, Taran. Hello, Sandeep Balani. Sandeep is the head of India for Outbrain, where he's responsible for advancing the market penetration of the entire range of Outbrain's product portfolio. Managing both the publisher and advertiser sides of the business, he has launched two ad tech platforms, Zimanta and Outbrain, in the Indian market. Congratulations, Sandeep, and welcome.
Thank you.
Moving to Ravi Santhanam, our CMO for HDFC Bank. In his current role, he is responsible for analytics, brand, and communication, while also being responsible for digitizing the entire customer experience. With a past stint in Vodafone, he feels privileged to have contributed to the current data-led revolution that is happening in the country. Hi, Ravi, and welcome. And hello, Sandeep Anand, CMO, food delivery for Zomato. I'm a big fan, by the way, of all of your work. Is an experienced FMCG food tech and consumer health marketeer. 16 years of experience in organizations like Reckitt Benckiser and GSK Consumer Health. And lastly, we have Nikhil Rungta. Nikhil is country manager for Verizon Media, responsible for growth of India businesses across leading consumer internet brands like Yahoo Cricket, Yahoo Mail, Makers India, HuffPost, and TechCrunch. He has led senior leadership roles at organizations like Reliance Jio, Housing.com, Yatra.com, and Google. Wow, this is an impressive panel. And I'm really excited to be having this conversation with all of you. So I'm going to jump right into it. Now, MarTech spends are rising. That is a fact. I was reading a report by an agency called Miram that said that 80% of organizations are keen to invest in MarTech tools over the next few years, and more so in the context of COVID. Let's start with Ruchira. Nokia's had the most interesting few years in the complex handset market. Now, talk to us about, in reference to MarTech, a success story at your end.
Yeah, so it's interesting, you know, when you say an interesting couple of years, absolutely. This has to be the most competitive industry possible. And I think what's changed for us on, and particularly on marketing for Nokia, because a lot of people come to me and say, hey, what are you guys doing? And we're like, you know, honestly, we've stopped following what used to be a very old, and I come from consumer and classic CPG, the product life cycle. You launch a product, you launch it, there's sustenance, and 18 months later, you come back and you say, okay, now we're relaunching it. It's got better, bigger, smells better, does better, whatever. From there, moving towards a consumer lifecycle driven approach, which is to say, where is the consumer today? And MarTech gives you the ability to do that, to say, and Pooja, you know this because we've worked with you on this, to say, where is the consumer? How long ago did they purchase a device, right? Are they in the market looking for a replacement? Are they looking for a second device because they have different needs? Are they looking to buy for someone else? And that life cycle is equally, I mean, we're still a nation where smartphone penetration hasn't really hit the 90 plus. We're still at a 35-40%. So you've got consumers, and by the way, our base of consumers, the belly of our consumers, are people who are coming in for feature phones, who've trusted and loved the Nokia brand for years and now are coming into the smartphone market and looking for that assurance. So one thing that we did earlier this year, and it was with Glitch, in fact, was when we launched Nokia 2.3, and we went to a 2 series consumer who'd bought us maybe 2 years ago. We knew that there'd be a time when they'd be looking for an upgrade. We knew which features they'd be looking to upgrade, but that they'd like to stay with the brand because their experiences were great. And we worked not just with the agency, but also with our media partners to say, in an integrated approach, to say, what's that decision journey? And the decision journey, as per some study I saw at Google, is between 20 to 500, has 20 to 500 stops on the way, which means between deciding that you want to consider something to when you finally purchase it, you might even make as many as 100 stops. So how do we make the right interruptions? How do we do the right remarketing? How do we speak in a language that's relevant for that moment? And we've seen terrific uptake. So we launched with a replacement guarantee message, which was a first ever for the smartphone category. And it went like, it's gone like the blazes. And then comes COVID and everything that comes with it in terms of wanting assurance and trust. And suddenly that message is even more resonant. And when you start talking replacement guarantee versus megapixels, you can see that, you know, you're actually seeing the kind of traction. So for us, that was a success story on two accounts, really. One is, how do you talk in one language across the entire decision journey for the consumer? And the second is, at the right points, you keep finessing that message. You know what they like, what they don't like, what's converting for you. So it's a wonderful place when you've got data. And I'm loving the fact that we can actually work with our partners and, you know, literally throw the challenge to you guys and say, hey, come back and tell us, what do you want to do tomorrow morning? Because this is what we're learning from all the insights that are being funneled through. So That's been the journey for us, but I'm sure there'll be lots of other really interesting examples from this panel, which I'm dying to hear about as well.
Thank you for that, Richard. Now, talking about data, and I'll jump straight into HDFC Bank here, because Ravi and the banking business has basically been the front runners in adopting MarTech tools. And it'd be so interesting to hear about a success story that you would like to talk about, Ravi.
I'll take the example what Richira was quoting, and I'll build on that. See, the biggest advantage of being a bank is all about the fact that when they actually bought the last phone, we get to know. And when they actually went ahead and ordered in Zomato also, I get to know. So it's a question, if you don't use it only, there is a problem. If you use it, there is a lot more advantage of what we can do about it. And the fact that we have a huge amount of first-party data, so the simplest thing for all of us have to do is to figure out, how do we actually leverage that? And what kind of science that you can put behind that? And then put all your marketing hat in figuring out, saying, if this customer, we know about it, they do have a tendency to spend on a Friday or on a Saturday at this point of time, whether they're going to buy a mobile phone, because 18 months back, I saw a swipe in my card. We can figure out a lot of these things. Then it's a question of reach. So what we needed to have is to have a clear data platform and then do-it-yourself activation layers, as we call it, in terms of trying to activate the data in the right medium, right messaging. And for many of our products today, for example, we are the biggest direct distributors on digital loans. I do more than 1,500 crores per month prior to COVID. A month, pure straight through, because we do know who's the customer, what they're going to buy, and we just have to be there and create a path for the customers to go through it. So if you have the data and if you don't use it, it's a crime.
Thank you for that, Ravi. Coming to reach, I want to talk to Zomato and Sandeep, and I'm sure you have a lot to add here. Over to you.
So yes, well, banks have all the data. We also have a lot of daily active users who come to the platform. And honestly, the richness of data is something which keeps this platform going, because once you understand what are the preferences of the user, and I'll give you an example in terms of, if there's a user who prefers to eat on the weekend, a lunch because they are ordering for their family and themselves. There would be a certain set of restaurants which they would order from because they're ordering for their family, and the cuisine would be like that. Versus when they order on a weekend, on a weekday, it would be a very different kind of a lunch and a very different kind of a restaurant you would operate at. So personalization is actually the name of the game. And that personalization is impossible if you don't have the right kind of data. The beauty of personalization is that you can use it to enhance preference, and you can also use it to enhance the consideration. Also, it works for the organization also, because you can use it to enhance value or the bottom line for the organization too. So data is the king, whether it's driving top line or bottom line, and whether it's also actually generating consumer love.
You're absolutely right about that. And I'm keen to hear from Sandeep Alani of Outbrain. I read on your website that you enable 250 billion monthly discoveries.
Yeah.
And that would be interesting to hear. Tell us a bit about that, please.
So yes, it's all about utilizing data for effectiveness of, you know, changing the consumer behavior as well. So a lot of marketers use Outbrain, where we understand the cookie data on the publisher websites. However, the trends that we have started seeing in terms of MarTech platform, we have started seeing a lot of advertisers enabling their first party data to target users on our platforms. Also, a lot of advertisers are using third party data platforms where they integrate their data with Outbrain to, you know, target users with pin code targeting, or like Sandeep mentioned about, you know, day parting, where, you know, you target user at a specific day or a specific time of their usage. Right. So the way Outbrain enables is, though we have huge data sets with us, we allow our advertisers to target a specific set of users which are more relevant to them at that point in time. Right. Because otherwise, if you're just targeting for reach, of course, when you want to do a launch campaign, I think that makes a lot of sense. But once you are already established brand and you have a huge data set with yourself, what makes sense for you is, you know, using that data and targeting those specific set of users at the right point in time. And that's where, you know, Outbrain as a technology partner comes in, where we enable all the advertisers to, you know, target these users at the right point in time on the right side of publishers.
Sandeep, is there a success story that you want to talk about? Anything that would stand out?
So, I mean, there definitely, you know, a lot of pharma clients are currently in the current environment utilizing Outbrain. I mean, success story, definitely we cannot name the client right now, but I mean, what we are seeing is the scale that they are using and the targeting that they are using right now. Especially with real estate clients, because, you know, right now real estate is in a category which is looking to, you know, sell a lot of inventory. And we are seeing a lot of real estate clients using pin code targeting as a specific option. So supposedly a particular real estate client has a certain property in Thane, right? So they'll target only Thane as a region and utilize that particular data sets of users to target in a very niche manner, right? So we are seeing utilization of targeting options going really up, because the advertisers have become more cognizant about their data. They have started understanding their users better, right? So initially, you know, when we launched Outbrain in India 5 years back, we used to see advertisers target users a lot more randomly. But right now I have seen the evolution of advertisers where they not only understand their data sets, but they also utilize programmatic platforms in a more intelligent manner by integrating data. And I think that leverages the power of platforms. And that's where I do see the maturity curve going really high in the last 5 years. That's what we are seeing right now.
Awesome. Thanks for that, Sandeep. Taranjeet, for you, you know, as an advertising tech company, really, what is your advice to marketers and everybody who's listening in right now? And what are the areas to invest in this new world?
Yeah. Thanks, Pooja. I think there are a couple of things to, you know, for us to kind of think about. I think COVID is kind of, you know, like it's a, the marketers have always had a problem of building relevance. I mean, that's a known problem. But I think COVID now is kind of making marketers look at it from a different lens. In my view, the opportunity is because there is not only change in consumer behavior, I think this pandemic is going to lead to a change in human behavior. I think the opportunity which brands have is to shape that. And any brand which is in the front, you know, leading in the front to shape human behavior, is the brand which will actually end up making impact. Now, from a MarTech point of view, I think all of my peers in the panel are talking about data. Yes, data is the new oil. And it's really, you know, and like companies like Zomato, HDFC or Nokia are like really ahead in the curve in managing their data sets. I think India at a whole is still a little way behind. I think there is a fair amount of thinking in terms to be how data should be used as an asset, because today that's the most valuable asset a company has. I think secondly, there are conversations which eventually would lead to is hyper-automation and hyper-personalization. I think these are the two most important things from a marketer's point of view, which will start shaping consumer behavior, which will start shaping how consumers interact with that particular brand. You know, COVID is teaching us a lot of things, and I think none of us on this panel can actually predict what's going to be 6 months from now in terms of consumer behavior. All we can hope is that we can channelize a certain amount of that user segment and, you know, win ahead and be ahead of that game. I mean, speaking, I think what would really help is talking about, you know, from an hyper automation point of view, I think there's going to be a lot of ML, there's going to be a lot of AI technology which is going to come in. I think there's going to be a fair amount of cloud adoption and IoT implementation across, you know, marketing channels, which I end up seeing. I think there is a bigger question which most marketers are asking themselves is a relevance of a DMP to a CDP. You know, DMP has been around for a while, but most of the marketers are now evolving their thought process to building CDPs because it helps them build personas, it helps them build profiles across multiple big data sources. I think those are relevant questions. And in my view, any brand which can solve for hyper-automation and hyper-personalization, I think it will be ahead of the curve, is what I have to say.
Thank you for that, Taran. Nikhil, there was one thing that I read on your website which I really liked that said you find new ways for partners around the world to connect. And now in context with really what's happening around us, what would be a good example to talk about?
I think, first of all, I think some very interesting thoughts that everybody has shared here. And, you know, one of the things that we are noticing and what is unique about us is that at one end, we are a publisher ourselves. We are also a marketer because we do brand and do branding and also promote our products. And we are also an ad tech company. So it's very interesting that we are able to see some of these angles, you know, very differently as well. So one thing that we are seeing going ahead is that, you know, the fundamentals of marketing don't change, right? What is marketing all about? Simply put, either you get new users or you get those users to use more. So those fundamentals don't change. What does MarTech do? MarTech just helps you, you know, make the process much more efficient. MarTech helps you improve the ROI, you know, I'm just using this platform also to maybe just not use much of the jargon here. I think that's what it does. And what we are doing is using some of the products or, you know, some of the stuff that we have to try and help the partners that we work with, how we can do these things, either get them to acquire new users or get them to engage and retain more users. One of the things that we have been building on, and you know, we're just terming it up through COVID, that marketers need to use more tact. And what is tact? Tact is essentially, you know, previously it was more about targeting, and now it's about tracing. I'm just picking up a term that is being used a lot during COVID days. So what is that? Essentially, it was previously just about how hyper-targeted you can go, but in the new world, it will be more about how well you know, and I think Ravi and Sandeep did touch upon that. Where did you buy? When did you buy? Whom did you buy it from? What time of the day? All of that will add a lot of value, and that's where MarTech will come in. The second, the A of the tact is, you know, you're moving from attribution to agility. I think more and more what we are realizing is that we need to figure out things in real time, not only, you know, reaching out to users in real time, but also analyzing that data in real time. Analytics is becoming a lot more influenced through AI ML today than it ever was. So it's now becoming augmented. Not just human experience is important, but it's being augmented through technology there. The C is we're moving away from just from care to now connection, you know, because care was just all about you sold a product and I have to take care of my user. But now it's actually more about how do we build those deeper relationships with them, you know, which is becoming more and more important. And through COVID, I think it will become more important because our feeling is instead of share of voice, it will be share of empathy. more and more of that will start going up. And finally, I think it's about trust me to transparency. All of us as marketers have faced that where we are saying, trust me, give me your data, I will not misuse it. But today, I think it's almost becoming that, please, you know, this is transparently, we call it out. Also, we are moving to, Ravi's touched upon third-party data to first-party data. I think now another emerging trend on top of that is zero-party data. With a world moving towards a world of cookie-less world, I think more and more important that users actually allow you to use their data. It's not just you know, putting a cookie on them or pixeling them. That's how you try and target them. It's getting into the next level there. So these are some of the things that we feel very strongly about and share with our partners and clients.
Thank you for that, Nikhil. You described that pretty well, and all and everybody else. I'm quite excited about the all of the examples that you guys spoke of. The part that I want to talk to you about is, you know, the maturity curve when it comes to investments in MarTech. And that is important, right? And as marketeers, as brand managers, we're constantly thinking about what are the areas that we should invest in. Should we even? Because so many of them really cost a bit of money. I want to have Ruchira and Taranjit answer this question, and either one of you can go first. But really talk to me about what is the mature, give me some examples of where you have invested in areas that you have seen results, probably a little later and not immediate, in because that's really what we're used to in this world. And Ruchira, let's start with you. And Taran, we can then get you to come in and talk about, you know, in your experience, what would your advice, really what your advice would be. So Ruchira, over to you.
Thanks, Pooja. I think, first of all, when you're investing, I think one of the conundrums has always been investing because it's exciting and it's new versus investing because it solves a business problem, right? And I think it's very clear that today businesses don't have the patience to look at you and saying, hey, we're going to try 15 different things, and it has to solve a problem. The second is, I think someone said this very, very well. I think it was Nikhil who said, at the end of the day, it's efficiency and ROI, which actually guides. It becomes a great lighthouse in terms of where do you want to put investments. And some investments we do late. And for example, I think last year, end of last year, we figured that we weren't actually leveraging tools on social media sufficiently enough, right? We weren't leveraging it in terms of the insights on what you could pick up on remarketing, on creating really a more meaningful consumer interaction. So that was a late realization. And of course, there are people who are doing it, but equally, I think we leverage that to turn around and say, okay, now if I want to target more meaningfully, how do I use really, really good tools to go online to offline? Because omni-channel is today, I think, the single largest priority for me. And when I say omni-channel, I'm saying, I don't care where you want to buy. I don't care where you're making those decisions. I want to be close to you so that when you're making those decisions, I have a solution for you. And where that takes us to is just saying, both business impact and solving the consumer's problem, right? And solving the consumer's problem at a relevant moment. So for us, omnichannel and COVID actually has been that precise moment where omnichannel has just taken off. So we did lead gen campaigns last year, and there was no appetite, not from the sales teams, not from retailers, not from anyone. Come April, suddenly we find people are thirsting. Before I could pass the lead in half an hour, we have someone delivering in Patna. Right? And what it tells you about is that there is a point when technology meets real life need, and that's when the maturity index goes through the roof. I mean, you know, last year at the same, I mean, at this time we were like struggling to get someone to return that call. Now he says, I'll deliver in 3 hours, and in half an hour he's delivered a device home, right? With three options. And then he goes back, and I mean, I am amazed by how, and kudos to the Indian entrepreneurial spirit. I think we say Indians are not entrepreneurial enough. That's not the case. A lot of people here on this call are great examples of that. But I'm saying the retail today is looking at saying, how do I get better at leveraging your digital insights and actually satisfying consumers? And they don't care where that lead comes from. Equally, if a retailer gives the lead and I satisfy it off my own Nokia.com site, they're equally happy because they know that they've got that consumer and that customer in their pocket. So for us, that's been a really, I mean, it's been successful, but we started at a point when maybe it was solving the business need, but we weren't much. I mean, the environment wasn't mature enough. And in the last 2 months, we're amazed by how we're able to turn around, on high value devices. So that's been great learning. I don't know about you, Taran. How do you see it?
No, you know, thank you, Ruchika. I think that's a great example. This also talks about hyper-personalization to a level because, you know, at the end of the day, you are reaching out to a customer and satisfying the need. I think for us, you know, we've historically been known as a company on remarketing and retargeting. But, you know, if you look at our evolution over the last 6 months, now we are working across the full funnel when it comes to marketing, you know, from awareness down to consideration and conversion. Our endeavor is to help, you know, marketers reach out to audiences in the most effective possible way, in the most hyper-personalized way. I mean, I'll give you an example. You know, very recently we've launched a first-to-market retail media platform, which has been launched in US and Canada, and that's going to be coming to this part of the world very soon, where the opportunity for brands is to work with retailers without using third-party cookies. So what a retailer can do is they're in 100% control of the data. They can have one-to-one conversations with their customers, you know, rather than relying on third parties. And more importantly, this gives them the opportunity to drive incremental revenue. So these are things which are happening, and this is how it's going to take shape. Like Nikhil talked about, you know, the cookie-less world very soon. The fact is that I think there are three strong convictions which we can look at. I think one is users control their ad experience, which will eventually create trust. And I think that's a very important aspect to look at. And that's where the hyper-personalization also factor comes in. I think second factor is user-personalized advertising provides multiple benefits when it's done right. Because we see better conversions. I mean, we are seeing better lower funnel metrics in terms of, you know, brands getting more ROI for the money which they're investing. And we feel that browsers and devices should not control user data portability. Actually, the users should. And, you know, if we look in this framework, I mean, you know, we've launched many products. We've launched a product called the Commerce Audience, you know, which helps in India, which helps, you know, customers and brands actually target better sets of audiences in a very hyper-personalized way through the creative DCO capabilities which we have. You know, we can actually customize creatives to about, you know, approximately 71 trillion possible combinations to a single user. And that's super hyper personalization levels, which any brand could drive. So, you know, that's what I have to say in terms of how you invest. You need to look at the trend, but more importantly, I feel the opportunity is to also shape, you know, and work with brands and advertisers to actually help them reach and achieve these objectives.
So if I can add one more point here, I think one more reason that I see that why probably the investment in MarTech will go up is also, I think there is now a certain awareness and a sensitivity towards brand safe environment. You know, a lot of marketers are not, you know, looking at putting their ads against certain kind of content. And there is a lot of, you know, talk going around that. And that's where I think people will start exploring how they can ensure, because see, we all of us live in this very social and vocal world wherein, you know, your ad appears against probably not so appropriate content, and it can snowball into a PR nightmare for the company. So I think that also, it's one of the things that will also drive a lot of marketers to look at, you know, what are the tools available for us to ensure that, you know, our ads are placed in the right environment. Who are the publishers that we are talking to? If they are helping us ensuring that we are not, you know, against something which will be a problem later on. So probably that will also, you know, add to this whole adoption. Especially, I feel in a country like India, we've been, you know, slow to adopt technology of any kind. And more so if we have to pay for it. Somehow we are happy spending a lot of money on top of the funnel, happy spending a lot of money, you know, on various other above the line forms of marketing. But when it comes to marketing technology, a lot of times I think we are slow off the, you know, so we need to try and figure that out. And I think COVID is probably might be, you know, demonetization was to payments and digital payments. Probably COVID might be to marketing technology, because you want better ROI, you want to be sensitive to your users, you want to have higher empathy.
Nikhil, since you talked about trust, I just wanted to share a small snippet. When we actually checked with our customers, because banking is all about trust and you have to keep my money safe, one of the biggest surprises that we got is they said, you know so much about me. So the trust is all about, are you going to be relevant? So the trust is no more about table stake is keeping my money safe. So the way of trusting is you have so much, so why are you not talking the most relevant thing to me? So the definition of trust from a consumer perspective also has been changing phenomenally. So if you don't use any of these technology tools, I don't know how you're going to be relevant to a customer.
Ravi, that's great because, you know, my next piece is really, you're learning this from your consumers and they're telling you all of these things. And that obviously takes you on a decision-making journey, right? On where to invest and how to invest. Now, for our audience, it'll be quick to get some tips from you guys, maybe some bullet points. And Ravi, we'll start with you. What is the decision-making journey for you when it comes to investments?
How much incremental revenue that we will be able to get. And being a bank, see, we have a bigger advantage because we don't have a product which cannot be sold digitally. Mm. Because most of our product at the end of the day is money, which is not physical in nature anyway. So how much incrementality I can bring into my business? And as Ruchira was saying, it always starts about, are you solving a consumer problem? Mm. Consumer needs money, and are you able to give the money pretty fast, with the quickest possible time, with the lowest amount of friction? So if you put that as the criteria, gate criteria for you to start off, you will add more value to yourself. And I think the best place to start is always put the data first against a use case. Because the amount of data that you can collect in today's scenario is so much and so humongous. And people will come back and tell you that hundreds of things they will collect the data with, but what do you use the data for? Mm. So the best thing to start with always is the use case, and then collect the data for that use case. You will realize the benefit, and then you can keep moving.
Thanks for that, Ravi. I have a question. You know, same question for Sandeep from Zomato. COVID obviously has completely changed the game for you guys, right? Can you talk to us about a few decisions you've taken here?
So the biggest one is be in sync with what the consumer sentiment is. And actually use technology to bring it alive. For example, safety is the top of mind for everyone in this COVID period. And how the safety as a theme kind of travels from right from the consumer places the order in the restaurant, how it's prepared, how it's picked up by the rider, and how it's delivered to the end consumer in a contactless manner. Actually, we tend to bring it alive to the consumer, wherein they can see live restaurant photographs, they can see live footage of the restaurant, they know that the temperature of the delivery rider when he picked up was X, and he did XYZ things before he actually landed up in front of his store to kind of deliver the order, and also then delivered it in a contactless manner. So technology can take what is the sentiment of the consumer and bring it alive for them right at their mobile, and which plays a big role in building trust and to a certain extent that reliance and relevance of that particular product in their lives.
Thank you. Sandeep, Outbrain, what about you?
So I would say that, you know, firstly, we need to enable the advertiser with the right tools. I mean, definitely all we clearly see that marketers need right targeting options. They have the data. I mean, they have the relevant data with them. But as a technology partner, we need to enable with them with the right tools. Like, you know, Nikhil mentioned that they don't need to appear near certain keywords, certain kind of pages. So maybe they want to block coronavirus as a keyword on a publisher page, right? Or do the right pin code targeting. So firstly, enabling the right tools to the advertiser, being effective, right? So if you're not able to reach out to the right user and at the right time, you will not be effective for the advertiser. So like Ruchira mentioned that, you know, the delivery was done within half an hour, right? So if the timing is not right, I think you will not be relevant for the advertiser in any ways. And also what we do feel that all advertisers today need ease of use, right? So today there are many platforms that all the advertisers are using, right? And all the marketers are looking at. If your platform is not easy to use and it's too complicated, or there are too much numbers which are making things complicated for them, I think that is something which as a company we focus on, that marketeers are easily able to use the platform and understand things in a simpler manner in one single dashboard rather than making it too complicated. So just these three things.
That's great. So far we got ease, revenue and sentiment. Karan, what would you like to add to this?
You know, so honestly, I mean, I would have similar to what Sandeep is talking about. I think for us, you know, my clients are my advertisers and brands who we work with. And, you know, for us, customer centricity is at the core of what we do. We very strongly believe that my customers' objections should be my objectives. And if I can solve for them, I think half the battle is won. For us, you know, the way we're looking at it is, you know, bringing in better efficiency. At the end of the day, I think there are five key principles which would really make it relevant in a time like this. Is one is, you know, acquisition of new customers, and how do you help, you know, one first part is just the acquisition part. But the second part is also building engagement and retaining them. I think that would be a very, very key thing. Now, post-COVID, we are seeing some sectors, like I think entertainment is on the rise, gaming is on the rise. I think food delivery services are really on the rise, considering there are very limited options for people today with no sporting events, no movie releases, everything at home. So the, you know, best way to celebrate is actually ordering. So, you know, we're seeing some great traction with Zomato. And, you know, I'm sure Sandeep would definitely share the sentiment. I think these are areas if we can help our customers solve their problems and help them, you know, capture this growth, which is coming to them, I think is one thing. Second thing is that there are also sectors like travel, which are struggling, and there are other sectors which have been affected really badly. It's about how do you keep the relevance in, because, you know, eventually in life, everything is a phase. This will or this shall too pass. We don't know when. We all hope soon. But, you know, eventually as a business, as a brand, you still have to build that longevity and you still have to keep your customers engaged to an extent. So we're trying to solve both the problems, and from our endeavor is to help, you know, deliver that at a very personalized, hyper-personalized way. And if we could help solve that problem, that's what it's all about.
Thank you. Nikhil, your inputs?
I think some actually extremely relevant points made by everybody. I would just say, I think having a longer term view, you know, I'm just carrying on for what I mentioned, like, and just from my own experiences in marketing, what I feel is probably one has to look at MarTech like we look at when we buy a consumer durable. You know, we are looking at buying a washing machine and we are investing that money today thinking that it will work for 10 years. So we amortize. But when it comes to MarTech, a lot of time, I think it's about what will be the investment I'm making today. But I think what it gives you over a period of time, and this is exactly what everybody else spoke about, that's very important from you know, some young marketers and everybody looking at this particular webinar. That's very crucial. The second thing I feel that one of my learnings has been is investing in talent and training. Because, you know, at times, that's also very crucial that you have the right people, whether on the partner end, which is your either your agency or your publisher or whoever else, plus having people in your team who will be able to, you know, give you the most out of the MarTech tool that you are trying to deploy here. Because, you know, you can have all the tools in the world, but if you not have the right people behind those tools, they might not deliver in the right way. So I think these are the couple of things that come to mind, apart from everything else that my co-panelists have mentioned.
Awesome. Ruchira, we'll take your view before we jump into questions. I have some key ones coming in already. Ruchira.
Yeah, so I think some really good points made. I'm going to refer to what both Nikhil and Taran said first about, I like calling it the efficiency to the equity continuum. And, you know, as marketers, we've grown up with saying, oh, brand, equity, and values. And then we swing to efficiency and say, okay, what conversions, lower funnel game am I playing? I don't think it's an option. I think both of them made that point really well to say, how do you actually, you know, operate in that continuum? And how do you consistently behave? And I think consistency with the consumer, regardless of where they are. So there was this really nice piece that we were looking at, which was talking about consumers going from safety to hope, mm-hmm. right? And in that continuum of a brand can play, you can be both functional and you can be highly emotional and you can actually travel the journey. So for me, that's been something that I think I would say have the tough conversations every day with yourself. What have I compromised on one to do the other in the short term? The second is like a lot of people referenced ROI and impact, hyper-personalization, optimization, and how do you actually deliver to those experiences? We had someone coming over and talk to us from Uber, and I'm going to borrow from what he said, where he said, you know what? In a country where we're so much about family and being together, that personalized feed on Netflix, that personalized feed news feed, we are actually increasingly becoming a market of one. An individual who wants to be talked to as an individual, and we don't even know that it's happening. We still believe we're this hum saath saath hai kind of generation, but we're moving to this, you know, speaking to one. How do you talk to that individual meaningfully, taking away the irritation? So, for example, the thing that I'm most excited about right now is shoppable content. I mean, you know, so we're sitting around here with two screens today on an average. I mean, I'm actually sitting in a room here, I just realized, with four screens. Bizarre, right? So I'm looking at these screens and saying, I can operate off a minimum of two, sometimes even three when something's running there. How am I actually operating? And I can make decisions where I am. I mean, if I'm in Ravi's shoes, I'm probably constantly looking at someone who can literally click and get something done. Like he said, it's not even a physical product. I mean, so that is, again, for me, big challenge that's going to come out of COVID. And, you know, post-COVID, it's happening. People are sitting at home and operating between screens, and exciting, really exciting.
Thanks, guys. This was very exciting. And we have a few questions that have come in, and some of them are targeted, some open to all of you. I'll start with one from Amesh Misra. The question is to Ravi. What MarTech tools have you implemented to arrive at a uniform customer ID, which is very critical for banks?
The banks have a clearly logged in data, so we don't have to invest in any tools to get customer data. So since you're logging in, you're giving me the entire information. So for audience, we don't collect data.
Okay, Anmesh, I hope you got your question answered. Anmesh Mishra, again, to Taranjeet. Leaving aside the walled gardens, which is Facebook and Google, which controls 90% plus of retargeting base, how does a platform like Criteo add incrementally to retargeting campaigns, and to what percentage can it make a difference?
So great question. I think if you look at it, and in our estimates, the industry estimates talk about it, that while Facebook and Google, the walled gardens, primarily only are, you know, I would say 50% of the user base across the world, because 50% is on open internet. It's sad to see that 70% of the adex is on those two platforms, but you know, brands like us can actually help you cover a far larger spectrum in terms of the open internet across the space. And that is something which I would request my marketing colleagues here to think about. So hope that answers. Ravi's smiling about it, Ruchira smiling about it, so I hope we can
Conversation. By the way, because of that question, the cookie crumble and all, I've been seeing it because we implemented GDPR in HDFC Bank, because we have NRI customers and all.
Right.
85% of the people, when we pop up saying that I'm putting cookies, are accepted. So it's like cookie crumble and all is like a useless thing.
Yeah, I'm pretty okay with it.
You have a point. I think it's going to work.
I think
Ravi, also, if you look at from an India point of view, because India is primarily an app-driven market, I think your cookie-less world wouldn't have that much effect on your consumer bases in India. So the in-app experience actually becomes really important to retain customers, and I think that is something which marketers need to start. I mean, think about it.
Sorry, I'm still muted. Thanks for that, Taran. The next question is by Satya Verma. On data, how do you see regulations impacting business, especially in the light of Sri Krishna committee recommendation? I actually have very little insight into this, but who wants to take this question? This is an open-ended question. I'll repeat it again. On data, how do you see regulations impacting business, especially in the light of Sri Krishna committee recommendation? Does anyone want to take this? No? Okay, cool. So we'll move on to the next one. This is by Tarun Sethi. Are the organizations in India really digitized and collecting all data points? Are there any omni-channels? Sorry, I'm going to reread that again. Are the organizations in India really digitized and collecting all points that are available on, or are they only omni-channel? This is also open. Ruchira,
yeah, so I can actually attempt to talk about it. I'm sure that Sandeep and Zomato will actually have a lot of stuff there as well. But first of all, I don't think we're digitized. Let's be absolutely clear. we're on that journey. We're getting there. We've probably seen a huge transformation. Like you said, Pooja, COVID, Chief Transformation Officer. You know, everyone is now going gangbusters and saying, how much do I really know? I'm sitting here. I'm not meeting them in a store. How much do I know? So first of all, and I think Amazon and Flipkart, while they were doing what they were doing, suddenly when our lives depend on it and when we see those screens coming to us, we've suddenly woken up to what that potential looks like, right? So so I think we're getting there. To your point on, to the question on omnichannel, I'm not sure if I have it right, but I think that's been the second big transition. Omnichannel earlier was, it was a difficult word. It needed a lot of back-end integration. It needed a lot of data sharing. You know, for example, a lead comes to me, I'm passing it on to someone else. I'm not sure I'm very comfortable with it. I'd like to hold on to it as far as I can. Suddenly we're saying, no, hold on. There's an opportunity, there's a consumer, and that consumer has a need. How do I deliver and serve at the lowest cost possible? So that's where omnichannel is going, and it can be a delighter. To your point on a cookie-less world, I don't think people worry about cookies. I don't think they worry about push notifications in this country yet. And this is, and I'm saying this as Nokia, and you know, we know that we've got a very, very loyal base of consumers who want pure Android and want none of those skins and no bloatware. But there's a large number of consumers who are happy with that experience. And they're happy with it because they want to be delighted in that moment when they're out and about and something comes and hits them and they're like, oh my God, how did they know that I am at this point in time looking for that restaurant with that rating, you know? So I think, Sandeep, I don't know how you feel. I think that's the big, that's the next big one, right?
So thanks, Richa. I think from a point of view of personalization, delighting the consumer, you're absolutely bang on. We have seen whenever we do something personalized for our users, there is an instant benchmarking which we can do, at least in terms of just pure CTRs on our push notifications. So that's definitely the case. To your other point of omnichannel, and I kind of agree with you, I think on omnichannel also, we have just started taking baby steps, and possibly COVID would be a revolutionary change in that digitization. I think someone earlier had mentioned what the demonetization had done for the payment industry. Possibly it will do, COVID will do the same for many other industries where omnichannel will become a norm rather than a good to have thing, because till now it was a very, very good to have thing rather than actually something we built consciously and reach out to the consumer in the right way at different touch points which we have. So we have a journey to travel as an Indian industry. To the question, yes, we are in the phase of digitization. I think that acceleration will happen on digitization and omnichannel will become a norm rather than a good to have thing, basically.
Just one additional comment, if I can add on top of this. I feel this is very true. And one of the things we are observing across the world also is, you know, because so many people now using connected TVs, I think it's becoming much more, everything is becoming digital, right? So we will be able to target them much better. Now there is some emerging new channels like digital OOH. I think out of home was one channel which was the most difficult to measure, but now slowly that's coming up into the fold. So as COVID, after COVID, as things open up and people are traveling and going out of home, I think there'll be a huge probably spike towards digital out of home. Even when it comes to things like radio or streaming of music, I think it's going totally programmatic. So there are a bunch of things which are creating a world where this whole thing about omnichannel is becoming a reality, and especially with the new technologies, whether it's IoT or AR, VR, there are a bunch of these things which are coming in. So essentially what that means is the world is becoming, from a marketer point of view, we need more granular, more relevant, and from our user point of view, much more immersive. So I think that's a big change that we probably all of us will see as we go along.
Yeah, I mean, just to add in, I think it's going to be a democratization, it's going to be democratized totally in terms of where it comes to technology. I think it's also going to become fairly affordable apart from being immersive for most of the companies.
Yeah, I would agree with you. And, you know, Sanjeev Kumar has asked a question saying that while we're all talking about MarTech softwares and, you know, how COVID is going to change the game for everything, brands usually invest in one or two softwares. And that is largely due to budgets. So to the brand guys here, do you see your budgets increasing post-COVID? I have that question too. So, who wants to take it? Ravi, let's start with you. Are you going to give your agencies more money?
Definitely, yes. And we strongly believe in HDFC Bank. Every crisis is an opportunity for us to go to the next level. And, this is a crisis and we will use this crisis to go to the next level.
Okay, cool. That's good to hear. Ruchira, what about you?
You know, that's a million-dollar question for all of us, especially for a global company with markets like Italy and Europe, etc., as part of the whole portfolio. But to add, you know, just to reply to that, I think there's no doubt that people are now going to come back to spending. I think there's been a hiatus. There's no doubt about it. They're going to come back to spending. And I think the spends are going to be sharply correlated to propositions in market. If you have the right propositions for this consumer, because right now as a business, you wouldn't spend behind a proposition that's irrelevant. So I think it's something that, and we're seeing a lot of traction for our devices. We've got a very strong portfolio under 10,000, which means that a lot of you guys on these screens possibly don't buy our devices, but really that's the belly of the market. And we're seeing tremendous pickup on our devices in that portfolio. So if you have the right proposition, absolutely. This is the time to go back and hammer home why your brand is going to be relevant. Someone spoke about that. Ravi spoke about how you've got to stay relevant. If you've got the right proposition, this is the time to go hammer and tongs after it.
Yeah. Awesome. Satya, I hope you heard. That was Sanjeev. Sanjeev, hope you got that. Sandeep, do you want to wrap this up and give us a view from Zomato? What are you guys thinking? Clearly, there's been a whole disruption in the way you guys function. What's the marketing wallet look like?
So see, in the world of COVID and post-COVID also, I believe that the sentiment will not, we will not have a V-shaped recovery for sure. I think it will be a bit of a tentative kind of a recovery. That's what we are seeing even from in the unlock period, which we are seeing. Although having said that, I think MarTech tools, etc., will have a very bright future, because in the continuum of effectiveness and efficiency, they possibly have a very sweet spot. The traditional forms of advertising may not pass the checks of efficiencies for sure, whereas all the tools at our disposal in MarTech may possibly do that. So I see organizations like ours definitely ramping up investments on that side, but overall I see budgets being a challenge, marketing budgets being a challenge.
Okay guys, so we've heard from two sides of the spectrum. Everyone knows who to call. But on that note, I'm gonna say thank you to everybody for taking the time to doing this. I obviously have learned a lot, and I'm sure our audience is as well, because we have a lot of questions coming in, and you know, some of them we will email to you guys. But everybody, thanks a lot for taking the time to doing this, and have a good evening, have a good weekend.
Thank you, Pooja.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for hosting this. Thanks so much.
All right. Bye.